In today's lecture, we are going to derive Coulomb's law from Gauss's law. So in the starting of this chapter, we had done what is Coulomb's law, and then we did what is Gauss's law, and we saw the various applications of Gauss's law. So in this lecture, we are going to derive the Coulomb's law from Gauss's law. So what is Gauss's law? The mathematical form of Gauss's law is that the closed surface integration of the electric field, closed surface integration of the electric field, and what is the closed surface? It is the Gaussian surface. It is the imaginary Gaussian surface that is drawn. So the closed surface integral of the electric field over the Gaussian surface is equal to the charge which is enclosed by the Gaussian surface. Let's say the charge is Q, divided by epsilon naught if the charge is present in the vacuum. So then we have 1 by epsilon naught. So this was the mathematical form of Gauss's law. Now we are going to derive the Coulomb's law. So first of all, here we have a charge Q. So this is the source charge. This is the source charge Q, and there is a test charge Q naught which is present at a distance of r from the source charge. So the Q naught, it is the test charge which is present at a distance of r from the source charge. So the first step will be, so we have to use the Gauss's law to derive Coulomb's law. So using this statement, we will derive the Coulomb's law. So we will be using this statement, this mathematical form. And in this mathematical form, what do we have? We have a Gaussian surface. So in this system, we will first draw a Gaussian surface. So Gaussian surface will be a spherical surface. It will be a sphere of radius r with Q as the center of that sphere. So first of all, we will draw a Gaussian surface. So this is the Gaussian surface. It is a spherical surface with center as O point where the source charge is placed. And Q naught is the charge which is present on the surface of the sphere. So Q naught, it is a test charge which is present on the surface of that Gaussian surface. So first of all, we will use this Gauss's law, and in this Gauss's law, what do we have? The surface integral of electric field. So this charge, this is a source charge, it will have certain electric field. So let's consider this point as P point, and this is the observation point. So at P point, first of all, we will draw a small Gaussian surface. We will draw a small surface element. So the surface element is ds, and ds vector will be in this outward direction. So ds vector, it is the surface area vector. So we have taken a small patch, a small surface element we have taken on the outer surface of the sphere. And this surface element, it will have some area. So let's say the area is ds, and the direction of the area vector will be perpendicular to the surface. So it will be radially outwards. Now the electric field of this source charge, the electric field strength due to this source charge at this observation point, that is at the position of the test charge, what is the electric field? So let's say that is E vector. So E vector, it will be also pointing in the radial outward direction. So the electric field is E vector. So E vector, it can be written as a magnitude times the direction. Direction is r cap. So E vector, it can be written as this form. Then ds vector, it has magnitude ds, and its direction is also r cap. It is also radially outwards. So now we will put these terms in this equation of Gauss's law. So we will get the surface integral, closed surface integration of E vector dot ds. So E vector is nothing but E into r cap. Then we have dot product with ds vector, and ds vector is ds into r cap, is equal to the charge which is enclosed by the Gaussian surface. So the charge which is enclosed is nothing but small q. So the right hand side will remain the same, q divided by epsilon naught. Now E and ds, these are just the magnitudes, and we have r cap dot product with r cap. So r cap dot product with r cap will be equal to 1. So you will just get closed surface integration, magnitude of the electric field intensity at point P, into ds, which is the magnitude of this small surface. That will be equal to q divided by epsilon naught. So now we are doing the surface integration. We are doing the closed surface integration. So if you will take any other point, let's say if you take point over here, this small area, if you will take, let's say if you take it at this point, then the electric field, it will point in the radial outward direction, and ds vector will also point in the radial outward direction, and the electric field, magnitude of the electric field will be same as the magnitude of the electric field at this point. So at all the points which are at a distance of r, at all the points which are at a distance of r from the source charge, electric field will remain the same. The magnitude of the electric field will remain the same at all the points on the surface of the sphere. So in other way, we can say that at all the points on the surface of this sphere, the magnitude of the electric field will remain the same. So E, it will be independent of this integration. So E will be a constant. It can be taken outside the integral. Then surface integration will remain as it is, and it will be on ds. So that will be equal to q divided by epsilon naught. So here we have a closed surface integration. So closed surface integration will be nothing but the total surface area of the sphere. So this will be nothing but the total surface area of the sphere. And what is the total surface area? So this is a sphere. The total surface area of a sphere is 4 pi r square. So from here E will be equal to E into, you will get E into 4 pi r square, that will be equal to q divided by epsilon naught. So from here you can get the magnitude of the electric field. So E will be equal to, so 4 pi r square can be taken on the right hand side. So you will get 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q divided by r square. So this is the magnitude of the electric field that you will get from this equation. Now we will insert this expression of electric field in this formula. So E vector, electric field in vector form will be E into r cap, and what is E? It is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. So this we have already derived, it is 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q divided by r square times r cap. So this is the electric field. This is the electric field at P point due to the source charge q. Then what is the force on the test charge which is placed at this point P? So now we are going to find the force at this test charge Q naught which is placed at point P. So until now we have derived the electric field at P due to the source charge. If we have any other charge placed at this observation point, then some force will obviously act on this charge. That what is the force? Force is nothing but charge into the electric field which that charge is experiencing. So charge is nothing but q naught, and the electric field which it is experiencing is E vector. So this E vector is due to the source charge. So force which is experienced by q naught test charge, that will be equal to q naught into the electric field which is present at the position of the test charge. So that is nothing but 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q divided by r square. So force acting on this test charge q naught will be equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. So now we will put this equation over here. So q naught will remain as it is, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q into q naught divided by r square into r cap. So this is the expression of force that you get. The force which is acting on a q naught charge due to the source charge q, keeping in mind that both charges, they are separated by a distance of r. So force vector will be equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught q into q naught divided by r square into r cap. And this is nothing but Coulomb's law. So this is the derivation of Coulomb's law from Gauss law. The next topic is the differential form of Gauss law. Earlier on we have discussed about this form of Gauss law, and this form, in this form what we have? Integration. So this is called as integral form of Gauss law, and now we are going to derive the differential form of Gauss law. So integral form of Gauss law, we have been doing this formula. So this is closed surface integration of electric field is equal to Q divided by epsilon naught. So using this equation, using this integral form of Gauss law, we will derive the differential form of Gauss law. So first of all, on the left hand side, here we have the surface integration, we have the closed surface integration. So now we will make use of Gauss divergence theorem on the left hand side. So what does Gauss divergence theorem? It states that the volume integration of a divergence of a vector field. So you can go through the first chapter where we have discussed the Gauss divergence theorem. So Gauss divergence theorem, it states that the volume integration of divergence of a vector field is equal to the surface integration of the vector over a closed surface. So this is the definition of Gauss divergence theorem that we have been doing. So that is the volume integration of divergence of a vector field is equal to the surface integration of the vector field over a closed surface. So now we will make use of this equation. So on the left hand side of the Gauss law, what do we have? We have a closed surface integration of E vector. And in Gauss divergence theorem, you can see we have closed surface integration of A vector. So in this article, instead of A vector, what do we have is E vector, which is the electric field. So this Gauss divergence theorem, it applies to all the vector fields. It applies to all the vector fields. It can be A vector, B vector, C vector, any vector field. Here we have only the electric field vector. So we can replace A vector with E vector. So Gauss divergence theorem will also apply on the electric field vector. So you can replace A vector by E vector. So then you will get closed surface integration of E vector will be equal to the volume integration of divergence of E vector. So instead of A vector, you have to write E vector. So then you will see that the closed surface integration of E vector will be equal to volume integration of divergence of E vector. So this we have made use of. In this step, we have made use of Gauss divergence theorem. Now the charge Q, this point charge Q, this can be any type of charge. It can be a surface charge. It can be the charge which is distributed on a line. It can be the charge which is distributed in a volume. So this charge in general, it can be written as the volume integration of the volume charge density. So this can be written in this form, because rho is nothing but the total charge divided by total volume. So this charge, it can be written as the volume integration of the volume charge density. So this concept we have already done in the first lecture, where we started the first chapter of electric field, that the charge can be written as integration of rho dV. So rho is the volume charge density. It is the total charge over total volume, or you can say it is the charge per unit volume. So charge per unit volume into the small volume, charge per unit volume, which is rho, into the small volume element. This whole gives us the charge present in this small volume. So rho into dV gives us the charge present in this small volume. And then when we do the integration over this small charge, which is present in this small volume, it gives us the total charge on the whole volume. Now, let's say this is the first equation, this is the second equation, and this one is the third equation. So the left hand side of the first equation, it can be written as, using the second equation, we can see the left hand side, it can be written as volume integration of divergence of E, and the right hand side, here instead of Q, we can write as volume integration of rho into dV. So we will just insert second and third equations in the first equation. We will insert second and third equation in the first equation. So we will get on the left hand side, here you will use the second equation. So you will insert this right hand side on the left hand side of the first equation. So you will get the volume integration of divergence of E. That will be equal to 1 by epsilon naught will remain as it is into Q. And what is Q? It is volume integration of rho into dV. So from here 1 by epsilon naught, it can be taken inside the integral and it can be written as rho by epsilon naught. So on the left hand side we have a volume integration and on the right hand side also we have volume integration. So we can equate these quantities which are present inside the integral. So on the both sides we have volume integrals, we have three integrals over here and we have three integrals over here. So therefore we can equate these terms which are inside the integral. So therefore divergence of E vector will be equal to rho divided by epsilon naught, and this equation is called as the differential form of Gauss law. So this first equation, the first step, this is called as the integral form of Gauss law, and using this equation and also the Gauss divergence theorem, so using the integral form of Gauss law and the Gauss divergence theorem, we ended up at the differential form of Gauss law. So on the left hand side we have divergence of E vector and on the right hand side we have the charge density divided by epsilon naught. In the next article we are going to study the mechanical force which acts on the surface of a charged conductor. First of all, in this article you have to keep in mind we have a charged conductor. So we have a closed conductor. So let's say you have a sphere which is a conductor. So you have a spherical conductor and that conductor is charged. And the fact that you have to keep in mind is that the charge always resides on the surface of a conductor. So let's say you have a sphere. Let's say you have a spherical conductor which is filled from the inside as well. So it is not a shell, it is a spherical conductor which is filled from the inside as well. So it is not hollow, it is filled from the inside. Now when you add up some charge on this conductor, so let's say you add 2 microcoulomb of the charge on this spherical conductor. So it is the property of a conductor that no charge is present, no charge resides inside the conductor. All the charge, it goes on the outer surface of the conductor. So this comes from the fact that inside the conductor electric field is zero. So there is no electric field which is present inside the conductor. Hence, if we add up the charge on a conductor, so that whole amount of charge, it gets resided only on the surface. So no charge is present inside the surface of the conductor. All the charge, it resides only on the surface of the conductor. So here we have uneven shaped conductor. So this is a closed conductor and we have uneven shaped conductor. In this article, we are going to find the mechanical force which acts on the surface of a conductor. So what do we mean by mechanical force acting on the surface of a charged conductor? So here we have some uneven closed conductor and we have taken a small patch. So this is a charged conductor. Some charge will be present and that charge will be present only on the surface of this conductor. So now I have taken a small section, small patch of the conductor. So let's say I have taken this patch. Now some charge will be present on this patch and some charge will be present on the rest of the conductor. So there will be some electric field. There will be some electric field, or you can say there will be some force which will be acted upon this patch of the conductor. So what does this mean? Let's say if you have a charge Q over here, and you have another charge, let's say Q2. So let's say this is the Q1 charge and this is the Q2 charge. So this Q1 charge, it will apply some force on this Q2 charge, and this Q2 charge will also apply some force on this Q1 charge. So using Coulomb's law, we can find what will be the magnitude of the force which will be acting on these two charges. So Q1 will apply force on the Q2 charge. Similar is the case in this closed conductor, in this charged conductor. So I have taken a small patch of this conductor. So let's say this patch, it represents Q2. So it is just a comparison that I am making just to make you understand. So let's say this represents Q2 and the rest of the conductor, it represents Q1. So this Q1, that is the rest of the conductor, the charge which is present on the rest of the conductor, it will apply force on the Q2 charge, or you can say it will apply force on this patch of the conductor. So there will be some mechanical force which will act on the surface of a charged conductor. Now this patch I have taken only on the surface of the conductor because only the surface of the conductor is charged. So charge is present only on the surface. I have taken a small patch on the surface. So there will be some charge present on this patch, and let's say that represents Q2, and the charge present on the rest of the conductor, let's say that is Q1. So this Q1, it will obviously apply force on Q2, which means we can say the rest of the conductor, the charge which is present on the rest of the conductor, will apply some force on the charge which is on this patch. So there will be some mechanical force which will act on the surface of the conductor. So this is the charged conductor, and area of this patch, let's say the area of this patch is capital S. So this is the area of the patch that I am considering, and the surface charge density. Now we have a three-dimensional conductor, but we are talking about surface charge density, and this is because in the case of conductor, the charge is present only on the surface. So therefore we talk about surface charge density, and let's say in this case it is equal to sigma. Now force acting on a unit area. So the main motive in this article will be to find the force acting on a unit area of a conductor. So first of all, we will find the force acting on this patch. Then we will divide that force by the area of this patch. That will give us the force acting on a unit area. So let's say this is the unit area. This is unit area. And on this area is experiencing, let's say, electric field E vector. So there is some electric field present in the position of this area, and area is unit. That is, it is one unit. The area is one unit, and electric field E vector, it is acting on this unit area. So force acting on a unit area, so that is represented by small f vector. So force acting on the unit area will be equal to charge into the electric field. So there will be some charge which will be present on this unit area, and let's say that charge is Q. So the force acting on a unit area is nothing but equal to charge into the electric field which is present on that position. So let's say electric field is E vector and charge on this unit area is Q. So this is just, we are supposing that Q charge is present on a unit area, and electric field experienced by this unit area is E vector. So force acting on a unit area will be charge into the electric field. So now we need to determine the electric field experienced by the charge. So to find the force acting on a unit area, what do we need to find is the electric field which is experienced. So we need to find E vector. In this article, we are going to find the force acting on the unit area of the conductor. So first of all, we will find the force acting on this patch. Then we will divide that force by the area. That will give us the force acting on the unit area of the conductor. So force is found using the electric field. So first of all, we will find the electric field which is experienced by this patch, and that electric field will be due to the rest of the charge. So the same concept we have already done. If we have two charges, to find the force on this charge, first of all we find the electric field at this point. So let's say the electric field is E vector, and this E vector is due to the other charge. So E vector, it is due to the other source charge, and force acting on Q2 will be equal to force acting on Q2 will be equal to Q2 into the electric field which it is experiencing. So the same case will be done over here. To find the force on this patch, to find the force on the charge which is present on this patch, we have to find the electric field which it will experience. So to find the electric field which it will experience, so we have to find the electric field due to the rest of the charged conductor. So here I have taken this patch outside. So I have drawn the patch over here, and I have drawn the rest of the conductor in this manner. So we need to determine the electric field which is experienced by the patch. That is, we need to determine the electric field due to the rest of the conductor. So force that will act on the patch, the force that will act on the patch, that will be equal to charge on the patch into the electric field which will be experienced by the patch. So force acting on the patch will be equal to charge on the patch. So here we have taken Q2, charge on the patch into electric field on the patch, or you can say the electric field experienced by the patch. So charge on the patch, it can be easily found. So what will be the charge on this patch? Surface charge density is sigma, that is charge in unit area is sigma. Then area of the patch is already given, it is capital S. So what will be the charge on this small patch? It will be equal to sigma into S. So charge on the patch will be equal to sigma into S. So what do we need to find is electric field which is experienced by the patch, which is experienced by this patch due to the rest of the conductor. And that electric field on the patch due to the rest of the conductor, or you can say the other part of the conductor, is represented by E other. So this is the electric field intensity at this patch due to the rest of the conductor. So that is E other, and we need to determine this electric field. So we need to determine the electric field due to this rest of the conductor at this point. So the electric field at this point, so let's say slightly above the patch, the electric field due to the rest of the conductor will be E other vector, and let's say it is in this direction, so it will be E other vector. And slightly below the patch also, the electric field E other will be in the same direction, it will be E other vector. Since we are talking at this point at where the patch is present, so slightly above the patch, let's say the electric field due to this conductor is E other vector, just slightly above, and slightly below, the electric field due to this charged conductor, it is unchanged, and that is E other vector. So we are talking just slightly below and slightly above the patch. Now we are going to see what is the electric field due to the patch, because the patch is also charged, the whole conductor is charged, and we have taken a small section from this conductor, so this patch will also be charged. Now we are going to see what is the electric field due to this small patch. Now this small patch, it has area of capital S. And to find the electric field due to this small patch, we can draw a Gaussian surface. So Gaussian surface will be cylindrical, as we had done in the case of infinite charged sheet. In that case, we had drawn a Gaussian surface which was cylindrical in this manner. So we draw a Gaussian surface which is cylindrical, as shown over here. So electric field due to the charge on the patch. So the patch is also charged, there will be electric field above and below the charge. So here we have represented only the electric field above and below the patch due to the rest of the conductor. But this patch is also charged, and this patch will also have some electric field above and below it. So to find the electric field above and below this patch, we will use Gauss law. So we have drawn a Gaussian surface, and this surface, this patch, it has area capital S, and it has surface charge density as sigma. So we will find the electric field above and below this patch. So we will use the Gauss law. So using the Gauss law, we will have the surface integration of electric field over this closed Gaussian surface is equal to charge enclosed divided by epsilon naught. Now the charge enclosed by this Gaussian surface is nothing but sigma into capital S. So charge enclosed will be sigma into capital S divided by epsilon naught. And we will do in a similar manner the left hand side. So the left hand side, it will be broken into three integrals. It will be broken into three surface integrals. So one is for this upper surface, one is for this down surface, and one is for this curved portion of the surface. So the electric field due to this patch on the upper surface will be in the outward direction, and ds vector will also be in the outward direction. Similarly, for the patch on the downside, it will have electric field due to this patch in the downward direction, and the surface area ds vector will also be in the downward direction. Now on the outer curved surface of the cylinder, the electric field will be in the upward direction. So above the patch, the electric field will be in the outward direction, and ds vector will be perpendicular. So this is for the case of the curved surface area of the Gaussian surface. So this left hand side, the closed surface integration, it will be divided into three surface integrals. Now the surface integral on this curved surface, the surface integration on this curved surface will be equal to zero, because E vector will be perpendicular to ds vector. Now for the upper surface, we have E vector and we have S vector. So this total surface area is nothing but S vector, because this is equal to this area of the patch, and the area of the lower surface is also same as that of S. So on the left hand side, you will get three integrals. The middle integral, that is on the curved surface, that will be equal to zero. Now on the upper surface, we will get E into S, because they are parallel to each other, and the integration on the downward portion, it will also be E into S, because they are parallel to each other. So that will be equal to sigma into S divided by epsilon naught. So from here, electric field due to the patch itself, only due to the patch itself, will come out to be equal to sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught. So this is the electric field due to this small patch of the conductor. So electric field above the patch will be sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught n cap. Let's say n cap is the perpendicular direction, it is the outward direction. And at this point, the electric field due to the charge present on this patch will be sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught minus n cap. Now electric field at this point will be in upward direction. Let's say that direction is n cap, and electric field in the down at this point will be in the downward direction, and that will be minus n cap. And this electric field will be perpendicular to this surface. It will be perpendicular to this surface. And the magnitude of the electric field will be sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught. Now this electric field is just due to the patch. And this electric field E vector other, this is due to the rest of the conductor above and below the patch. Now we will draw this, all the electric fields. So till now we have E other, and we have this electric field and this electric field. So now we will draw all these electric fields in one diagram, that is in this first diagram. So now we have a patch over here. So slightly above the patch, we have E other, and that E other, this is due to the rest of the conductor. And slightly below, the direction will be same slightly below this patch, the direction of E other will be same. So let's say that is E other vector. Now due to this patch, now there will be electric field due to this patch also. Now due to this patch, we have already found that above the conductor, the electric field will be sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught, and that will be perpendicular. So that will be in this direction, which is perpendicular to this patch, that will be sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught n cap. Now slightly below the patch, the electric field due to the patch will be in the downward direction. So that will be in the downward direction, and that will be minus sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught n cap. Now we will write the resultant electric field. Above the patch and below the patch. That is above the conductor and inside the conductor. So E above vector, this is the electric field due to this whole conductor. So this is the electric field due to the whole conductor, but it is outside the conductor. So that is E above vector, and that will be equal to E other vector plus this vector. So that is plus sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught n cap. So we will do the vector addition of these two vectors. That will give us the resultant electric field. Above the conductor. Now below the conductor, that is inside the conductor, what will be the electric field? It will be E other. Then we will have the electric field due to the patch. And due to the patch, electric field inside the conductor is minus sigma by 2 epsilon naught. So we will have minus sigma by 2 epsilon naught n cap. So this is the electric field inside the conductor, and this is the electric field outside the conductor. Now we will use the property of the conductor, that for a conductor, electric field inside is equal to zero. Now this is the electric field, resultant electric field inside the conductor, and for the case of conductor, it must be equal to zero. So E below vector, it must be equal to zero. So if E below vector is equal to zero, then from this equation, you will get E other vector will be equal to sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught n cap. So E vector other vector will be equal to sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught n cap. So this is the form of electric field due to the other portion of the conductor. Due to the rest of the portion of the conductor, the electric field will be sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught n cap. Till now we have done the derivation using a charged conductor, and we divided the charged conductor into a small patch and the rest part of the conductor. So then we found that to find the force on this small patch, we need to find the electric field due to the rest of the conductor. That is, we need to find E other vector. Then, using the property of the conductor that inside the conductor, electric field must be equal to zero, we found this E other vector is equal to sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught n cap. So, this is the form of the electric field due to the rest of the conductor. So, now to find the force acting on the patch, we will multiply charge on the patch with the electric field on the patch. So that is nothing but E other vector, and that will be sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught n cap. So we will multiply sigma s with the sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught n cap. So the force acting on the small patch, which whose area was capital S, so force acting on the small patch will be sigma s, which is the charge on the patch, into the electric field which is experienced by the patch, that is E other vector. And using the property of the conductor, we found E other vector is nothing but sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught n cap. So we multiply sigma s with sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught. So F vector will be equal to sigma square into s divided by 2 epsilon naught n cap. So this is the force which is acting on a patch of area S. So this is the force which is acting on a patch of area S and with surface charge density as sigma. So force acting per unit area. So this is the force acting on a patch of area capital S. So what will be the force acting per unit area of the conductor? So we have to divide this expression by capital S. So capital F vector divided by capital S, that will give us force acting per unit area of the conductor, and that will be equal to sigma square divided by 2 epsilon naught n cap. So this is the final expression of force acting per unit area of the conductor. Now what is the mechanical pressure which is acting? Now mechanical pressure, what is pressure? It is nothing but force per unit area. So that is nothing but magnitude of force per unit area. So that is nothing but sigma square divided by 2 epsilon naught. So this is the mechanical pressure which is acting on the surface of the conductor. Now we will write this mechanical pressure in terms of the electric field. Now electric field above the conductor. So what is the electric field above the conductor? So we had written two equations. The E above vector was equal to E other vector plus sigma by 2 epsilon naught n cap. And the other equation was E below vector was equal to E other vector minus sigma by 2 epsilon naught n cap. But we know that inside the conductor electric field is equal to 0, so therefore we had put E below vector equal to 0. So in this equation of E above vector, so E above, it can be simply written as E vector, which is the electric field outside the conductor. So E above vector, let's say we write it by E vector. So this is the electric field outside the conductor, because inside the conductor electric field is 0. And E other vector, we have just found the expression of E other vector, that is nothing but sigma by 2 epsilon naught n cap. So we will insert this equation in this first equation. So we will get E vector, which is E above vector. So E vector will be equal to sigma by 2 epsilon naught n cap. So we have just inserted this expression into this one. So E above vector will be equal to sigma by 2 epsilon naught n cap plus sigma by 2 epsilon naught n cap, and that will be equal to sigma by epsilon naught n cap. So that is E vector. So magnitude of E will be equal to sigma by epsilon naught. So from here sigma can be written as epsilon naught into E. So in this equation we have sigma square divided by 2 epsilon naught. So we will put the expression of sigma, so that is nothing but epsilon naught into E. Now what is E? It is the electric field outside the conductor, and that is equal to sigma by epsilon naught. So we will put this equation over here and you will get another expression of mechanical pressure in terms of electric field, and that will be 1 by 2 epsilon naught E square. So you will put this sigma, which is E into epsilon naught, into this equation, and then you will get this final expression of mechanical pressure.